yeah, yeah, yeah. Count it. You already know. Shouts out to the Guillotine team. Hey, you over there, shut the fuck up. Listen, look, please don't talk to us. This is off the cuff. We off-white like a lemonade and swastikas. Hey, homie, I let the thing talk like a parakeet. Paraheat, the way I bully beats gets embarrassing. Came up, we used to chip 5 and a L. I know the rules of the game and surviving a hell. You know that it's rare. I know that you care. Check the faces. One bar, give you a shot. Blood can chase it. It's me and E. With some vehement knees. Women that I'm sure gonna make us weak in the knees. It's return of the gap, not return of the whack. Negative energy, we are not returning it back. You thought I knifed up a candle, how I'm murdering wax. Compare me to who? Nobody ever heard of they track. Need big did it, sick with it, you know who the man. Every rapper that you know, I done made him a fan. I let the tables rotate like the blaze on a fan. Know what we bout, action like charades with the fam. We not impressed, it heard no stress and tried to take it. Waiting on the time to talk back to basics. Acid, no laces, destiny, we can taste it. Foreign money, I need banks for translation. Competitors, out the regular, I'm ahead of ya. Everybody rapping is cool, I'm just better, bruh. It be the R like the 18th letter was. The foundation too strong, you can't level us. How long you been down? You gotta level up. It's my day like the dude from Bulgaria. A new day, keep boxes of O's, X's for hoes. I pointed out the routes on the roads. Rest in peace to the family, nigga, count me. You know?
Say, Young Z. Yeah, the West song. What it do? Tell them the West song. I do this for my dogs, my niggas. Doing life behind bars, take a shell for my niggas. Ain't no question, will I ride, for my niggas. I live by the cold, staying solid in the trenches. I do this for my dogs, my niggas. Doing life behind bars, taking shit for my niggas. Ain't no question, will I ride, for my niggas. I live by the cold, staying solid in the trenches. I love flossing, snatch a chain, the West Coast never change. Still hot, low rider, sliding on the Danny Dane. Sipping from the 90s in the 80s with the dope game. Blocks off limit, caught slipping, that's your throat, man, a violation. Beware danger, they some cutthroats, my dog's vicious. Even the pups let the tech go, we on a mission. Cause a friction with the youngest and babies loving. The night owl when I'm plugging, phone ringing me in, most time it ain't nothing. Phone block collect call from my motherfucking cousin. He said he having problems with some niggas in the field. I know it's time to get dirty, I already know the drill. Conclusion, toe tag let off when there's no pass, I'm gangster. In every shape or form, better know that. Them niggas quit the phone to pig, see many go bad. But I don't do new niggas, I only rock throwback.
I do this for my dogs, my niggas. Doing life behind bars, take a shell for my niggas. Ain't no question, will I ride, for my niggas. I live by the cold, staying solid in the trenches. I do this for my dogs, my niggas. Doing life behind bars, take a shell for my niggas. Ain't no question, will I ride, for my niggas. I live by the cold, staying solid in the trenches.
Fuck Raiders, Indians, and wives, we block bang. Black Chuck, gray laces, the black with the blue strings. My white pro club, sitting under my three chains. Tell my little homie, sick him and leave him in bloodstains. Any place I go, they respect me as a restable. Cannon blow like a snotty nose, but the shit not accessible. But hood famous since high school and M block. Serve you out the window, I ain't going out too hot. My dog in peace, we still keep it thugged out. I love my city, my whole state burnt out. Spinning corners in the city, blowing sticky icky. I see only G's, Chuck got a filter. I'm serious, point blank period. Quote dollar signs, platinum car, Visa this. Jaws are all stars in a dicky fit. Just know, the followers that get to lead us
for my dogs, my niggas. Doing life behind bars, take a shell for my niggas. Ain't no question, will I ride, for my niggas. I live by the cold, staying solid in the trenches. I do this for my dogs, my niggas. Doing life behind bars, take a shell for my niggas. Ain't no question, will I ride, for my niggas. I live by the cold, staying solid in the trenches. Three times.
What up? J-Mo.
Ballin' on a budget, blowing Girl Scout cookies and Louis Vuitton Dutchies. Serving fat grams of the plug, show you no love. Ain't nothing changed, still dickies or khakis with the pro club. Life's been a trip, I just wanna see the cash flip. Every day I hustle from the corner to this rap. Working 9 to 5 at a desk, we're at the corner store. Pushing marijuana with a sniff, call it bloody nose. The block on lock, don't try to creep on me. We'll squeeze on you driving slow with the beat bumping. Treat money like I'm having sex, watch it keep coming. Money make a strip for me, word to Biggie, get money.
Money
looking precious, I'm not into burning cash.
Nah.
Millionaire plans with a thousandaire salary. I'm making one day what you get paid on a weekend. Don't call me by my name, call me Young Zeke the King.
Yes, sir.
I hustle. I hustle. Money ain't nothing. I hustle.
And now do it. Now do it.
Pyrex, that Pyrex jar. Know a little more than usual. Cook it until it's beautiful. Move it in a Subaru. Cross state for some super loot. Come back to the city with more O's than a hula hoop. Who is you? Don't even matter. Tony Montana holding the blame up for holes that hate the size of bananas. Just break out the cameras, models from Atlanta on flam. She's stripping just for rising the fan.
Yeah.
I'ma finally break on. Like what you take me for? Choosing on the kid, yeah, I'm guaranteed a paper for. Game impeccable, change the schedule with raglets. Hitting licks for the chips and the chains acceptable. Don't make me call the hogs out. Mama said no pussy cats inside the doghouse chopper. 40, standing clips going all out. Do what I want and whenever I want to do.
I hustle, money ain't nothing. I hustle,
and now do it, now do it.
I hustle,
vibe with me.
I hustle, money ain't nothing. I hustle. I came from the struggle. I hustle for the finer things. Cares in my ear with a pocket full of collard greens. Small range, promise you I'm getting paid. Lima, palma, drama, hoping to shoot another way. Yeah, I party, hardly working, stacking up my cake. Catching California cake, and I'm the man in my state. More packs, pitching, doing no kissing. This American Express off of one transition. No hand in hand, I know them pigs probably watching. A nigga with an attitude, like I raised out of Compton. A native out the LB chunk to see up to my and the day passed by, I ain't trying to make some more cash. Who you know stay on that bread like pigeons do? With an automatic that'll turn you into pigeons too. Never spend a re-up if you do, how that work? I'm too ahead of time, I can never hustle backwards. I hustle, money ain't nothing. I hustle,
and now do it, now do it.
I hustle.
Fucking going on, man, nowadays, man. These little motherfucking, some of these youngsters, weirdos and shit, wearing colorful hair and all this old crazy tight ass clothes and shit. What?
You new rapping niggas sound sorry. Must have been dropped on your head when you was a baby. Used to daddy's baby. Mama was so shady. Didn't teach a nigga how to be a man that's crazy. They got a whole generation that don't give a fuck. They looking at the OGs like we washed up. Ha 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 ha. Think that shit is funny. And if you niggas not careful, you lose up all your money. Little homie, your shit is rad. Nigga, that shit is boo. Nigga, what you saying? I don't even understand you. Niggas be like, I'm a the video. Straight looking like Bozo. Man purse, tight clothes, bonafide, weirdo. Look stupid in the video. Straight looking like Bozo. Man purse, tight clothes. That ain't hip hop, where it go? These new rappers sound so retarded. Putting up that bumble rap garbage. Sound like a motherfucker. Like a porta potty. I be talking big shit like a porta potty. I be talking big shit. I be talking big shit. I be talking big shit like a porta potty. I'm talking big shit. Especially that I can back that up. Extended extra clip. Just in case a nigga will get tough. Nigga, back up on me. Back up on me, don't cross that line. Shit gon' get ugly. You fuck boy niggas running out of time. Everybody ain't about that lie. Shit get real when the bullets fly. Like baby mamas, they cry. And the son keeps saying when my daddy die. That's how I go down to the ghetto. Every day a motherfucker getting capped. Fuck weeks, nigga. Hit him in the Duke shoe. Hit him with a long way drive. Now fuck with a nigga think. Take it to the face. If it don't make dough, then it don't make sense. Fuck with a nigga do. What you gonna do? These niggas catch feelings like a broke ass bitch. I ain't giving no nigga shit. Better get off your ass and work hard, bitch. Better tell that bitch to go cop a squad. Get off the cops, go get your knife. The strong won't eat the weed. Can't nobody sit in my seat. Shut the fuck up and grown folks feet. Ever since the 90s, I kept the G. Now things don't seem the same. Little niggas run around with colorful names. And these new wave rappers should be ashamed. Should be ashamed. Should be ashamed. These new rappers sound so retarded. Putting out that mumble rap garbage. Sound like a motherfucker farted. And fucking up the game for real hard. I be talking big shit like a porta potty. I be talking big shit. I be talking big shit. I be talking big shit like a porta potty.
Like my nigga E-40 say, mob that shit out, nigga.
Yes, 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 what it do, y'all? This is your boy, King Eric the Great, and we are now tuned in at Off the Cuff Radio, sponsored by Da Vinci Clothing. This is the Guillotine at 4 Voltron, my man T-Max in the building.
DA up in the place, it's two up, two down all around, what it do, what it do.
Okay, we got Miss Chinchilla, we got to make sure she's aboard.
Already, what it do, what it do, is the girl Chinchilla with Off the Cuff Radio. How everybody doing tonight?
We Gucci here. Now I got my man Sandman, a lot of Sandman on board. Let me make sure everybody's aboard right here.
Uh-oh, you know I had to say it. 1-2-1-2.
What it do, what it do?
The Four Horsemen of Radio is in full effect right now. We have a special show lined up for tonight. We got my man Young Zeke from Dogghouse Records. He about to join us.
Hey. LBC City up in the place.
Yeah, the call in number for those who want to chime in. It's 1-619-924-0703. Press 1 if you want to ask questions. No trolling. Serious business going down right here. Because when we bring homie on, we about to be laced with some heavy good games.
Shit. If motherfuckers want to come up on here and troll, hey, troll at your own risk. Don't get mad at us. It's like the bitch.
For real.
Now, before we started,
I want to say this, though. Before we bring them on, the first thing I want to say is we want to send our thoughts and condolences to Rick Ross because he's currently fighting for his life.
Well, we don't want to say condolences yet because he's not ain't gone.
Yeah, to his family.
Yeah, he's saying condolences. Christ, like damn, he's still amongst us. This is king of mad dog.
Yeah,
all jokes aside, you know, but I heard, I don't know if it's true or not, but I heard he's off the life support machine, so that's good.
That's
news.
Good.
That's good. Good. That's very good. And they and no death behind it. So, Joe, dog, I was reading that procedure they did because they basically said they had to drain his blood out and oxidize it. And then they had to put it back in. And I'm not a doctor, obviously. I don't know if that meant that because they're saying heart attack, and heart attacks usually come where, you know, basically your vessels get blocked, you know, they get clogged.
I heard pneumonia. I ain't hear nothing about no heart attack.
No, they said it was a heart attack. They think it was a possible heart attack.
I heard
pneumonia.
First they were saying it was pneumonia. Now it's a heart attack.
They think it was a heart attack. TMZ, as ratchet as TMZ can be, TMZ gets it right a lot of the time. And that's basically what's circulating the wires right now, that they think it was a heart attack.
You know, it could be too, because he lost so much weight so fast, you know? He's had a history of getting sick a lot, especially when it comes to, you know, his season and stuff. Like, I used to get those too when I was young. That shit is scary. It feels like you're literally about to die.
Yeah. He said he attributed that to his, basically, you know, just working so hard, you know, not sleeping right, and just, you know, not living a healthy lifestyle, which prompted him to, you know, I don't know necessarily when he was signed to Reebok at the time. That was part of that CrossFit campaign that they were running, which was promoting the healthy lifestyle, doing exercises, you know, and everything. But that's when Ross really started getting heavy on his fitness swag, you know what I'm saying? Just, you know, getting himself, and this is going back like 2-3 years. So he actually, when he started slimming down, he had lost like 75 pounds. And at one point he was like 350, you know. And, you know, for a lot of our listeners out there who didn't know, may not have known this, he also used to play football and was offered a scholarship to Albany State University. I believe it's in Georgia. But, you know, he did actually go to school for a bit, but he left. He just felt like, you know, he just didn't feel school was for him. But he did play high school and, he did play high school football, and he was good enough to get a scholarship. So the man is familiar with the utmost imperative of being physically fit. You know, but to all our listeners out there.
So you think, like, basically that was, like, water weight that he, because, you know, he shedded those pounds so easily and so fast. So that was basically, like, nothing but, like, water weight.
Well, it varies, because when you're dealing with heart attacks can happen to anybody, anywhere. It can be stress. It can be your eating habits. Rest in peace to Erica Gardner, who was 27 when she died of a heart attack. And I think just the stress of what she was doing, you know, crusading in her father's name, you know, about police brutality, and, you know, just the stress of her father, you know, and the stress of what she was doing, you know, that killed her. But, you know, that is a lesson, because you can be any age technically and get one. It just depends on what happens.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, to our listeners
out. You don't have to be old to catch a heart attack.
No, you don't. No, you don't.
Can I touch on one thing that you said, T-Mac, too? Because you said something that a lot of people take for granted. You said lack of sleep. Now, you got a lot of rappers. You got a lot of business people. You got a lot of people, period, that will sit there and glow. I don't sleep. I work constantly. I'm on the move. I don't need no rest. Nigga, your body need rest. At the end of the day, that can cause a heart attack. It can cause stress on your body. It can cause a lot of other things, too. But people just take for granted the fact that they need to rest. You are not 12 anymore. 12-year-olds need to rest too. But I'm just saying, nigga, get your rest. Keep your water up, especially if you're on stage in the lights, if you doing TV, anything with a bunch of lights, a bunch of body movement, a bunch of body heat in the damn venue. Man, it don't matter. You need rest. You ain't no fucking immortal, nigga. You mortal. Get your rest.
Definitely.
Because you know what it is? People consider out of context. You know, because when people, like, a lot of busy people talk about, like, team, no sleep, and what may have you. It's just that, you know, they don't have, they have a career, but they just want to keep on working. because they get way more money or whatever. So it's like they're always on the clock. It's not like a 9-to-5 job. Like people took it out of context, like, you know.
Hey, but you so right. And on the cool, that's another thing that people put money above their health a lot of times. And at the end of the day, my nigga, if you're not alive, how the fuck you gonna spend your money and enjoy it? You gotta take care of yourself and create a balance. You know what I'm saying?
Church.
There's a balance in
there
everything. You know what I'm saying? That's all it is, balance it. Money ain't more important than your life, because once your life is gone, all the niggas that you left your money to is gonna be enjoying that shit while you're in the grave.
I gotta say this too. More than anything, and Chinchilla, you were so right on what you said about the sleep and how people try to give off that image about, you know, yeah, you know, I'd be on the grind, you know, I'd be working. I'm like, you know, yes, we know the hustle of what it is to get the muscle up and get financial, you know, weight and success, but it's also about taking care of yourself. And one thing that I cannot stress enough, you know, all the drinking, all the bad eating, you know, all that shit, man, you know, you got to cut that out. You know, artists, established and independent, whomever, if I know it's sometimes hard, well, I know, especially if you're starting out, but major artists out there as well, this is to you too. Invest in a personal chef who can cook you healthy meals on the road and take care of you, because, you know, all the fast food.
Hold on, let's before you even continue on, like,
yeah,
you know, so everybody's body is different. King, what was
right.
the name of that fitness trainer that we had on here? It was a few months back. What was
yeah.
her name again?
Her name was Brianna.
Brianna Beato, right?
Beato, yeah.
I think her name was.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, she was basically talking about that too. You know, it's, you know, everybody's body is different. Like, it even got to the point where she was saying that a lot of people would say that salt is bad. And actually, salt is good. It's just you can't use too much salt.
Right,
you need
right.
salt to stay hydrated.
Right.
And I never knew that. I'm like, you're the only person that ever said that. You're the only person that said that salt is actually good. But you know, when you go on a diet, they'll say, oh, lay off the salt and da da da.
And you know what? Just to kind of piggyback on what you're saying, not just some people have salt deficiencies, which can kill you, cause seizures, cause liver failure, and kidney failure. It can cause a lot of stuff. What people got to understand is what's good for one person may not be so good for you. And
exactly.
what's good for you may not be good for
yeah.
somebody else. You have to, number one, if you have the time, the insurance, the money, whatever it costs to go see a nutrition, to get your custom fit for your body, do so. You know what I'm saying? And
yeah.
listen to the people, your doctors or whoever speaking to you. Listen to them, because you cannot just go on somebody else's diet or eat what somebody else eats or stay
yeah.
away from what everybody else has to stay away from. Your body might crave, just like diabetics. You have some that can't have sugar,
mm-hmm.
some that need sugar. Everybody's body is different. So at the end of the day, listen to
people,
your body, number one. You
yeah.
got to listen
and,
to your
and
body.
You have,
you feel
and
the
you
same?
Have some people that's lactose intolerant. You have some people that's
exactly.
lactose intolerant, and they could still, you know, drink milk or eat cheese, but they can't consume it too much or they'll get sick. But if
right.
they consume just
right.
like a certain amount, they won't get sick, and they'd be lactose intolerant.
Exactly. And some people just don't listen to their body. Some people feel like they're going to faint, but don't stop what they do and go drink some water. Some people feel like they're going to be sick while they're smoking a cigarette or while they're doing whatever they're doing, but instead of sitting down, stopping what you're doing, you continue to indulge in what makes you happy, what you think makes you happy. At the end of the day, you have to listen to your body. If you don't listen to your body, you will regret it, and you're going to listen in that hospital bed if you're lucky.
Like, I'm a prime example. I'm a prime example. The last time I took my blood pressure was a couple of months ago. And high blood pressure runs in my family. And thank God I didn't have high blood pressure. My shit was, like, just right. And trust me, I don't eat pork. But when it comes to, like, burgers and tacos and pizza and Chinese food shit like that, I don't indulge too much. But when I indulge, you know, I goes in. You feel me? So it's a blessing that doing, like, shit like that for so many years, to say that to figure out that, you know, I don't have high blood pressure. That's what I'm saying. Everybody's body is different. you know, some people can't take that much sodium, and their body would lock up on them.
Yeah. I mean, go to the doctor, get your checkups annually, make sure that everything's working like it should, you know what I'm saying? Because you can get ahead of it, you know, if there's something going on, but, you know, if you don't, it could be too late by the time something happens. So, you know, just be healthy. Off the Cuff Radio is all about health, fitness, mind, body, and soul, physically and mentally. Do what you got to do to keep yourself right at all times.
There you go. We're going to close it out on that end. So, we send our prayers out to Ricky Ross and hoping that he get a speedy recovery and that he can drop some boss gems. But this is the moment of the show right here where we're going to bring on our guest of the night, my man from the LBC, Dogghouse artist, and he's celebrating his birthday with us. We got my man Young Zeke in the building. Let me bring you on right here.
What it do, fam?
You on, brother? Hold on, let me give you a round of applause right quick, man. Gotta put respect on you, bro. From the LBC to the East Coast, man.
Welcome.
Yeah, man. Definitely.
And we welcome you from the Hall Guillotine. We appreciate you and happy birthday. You celebrated us with us tonight. We appreciate that because you sure could have been somewhere else.
Oh, yeah. You already know, man. It's all a blessing, man. Another year to add on and do some great things, you know?
Definitely, definitely. Happy birthday, man. So,
I appreciate it.
But definitely, Lee.
First off, welcome. We know you repping that. We know, look, you probably rep that LBC city, man. I mean, and the pedigree of which you come from there. I mean, Warren G. I mean, you know, Snoop repping. I mean, just so many P artists coming from there. How does it feel to be, you know, one of the latest and greatest to come out of your city, really putting it down for the town and being part of Snoop, you know, relaunching Doggy Style, you know, Dogghouse Records? How does that feel?
Oh, man, it feels great, man. You know, I've been on the grind for a few years, so, you know, just to be, you know, one of them names that always come out the hat, you know, dealing with a city that come, you know, dealing with a lot of talent coming up out of Long Beach. Everybody want to be rappers and all of that. You know, to be one of the top, you know, three names coming up out the hat, man, it's a blessing.
Okay,
you know?
That means we gotta get a petition to XXL to get you on the freshman list, the next freshman list. I was checking out some of your stuff on YouTube earlier doing research, and you got some, you got some heat. You got some heat.
Got some ham and eggs.
Yeah.
Okay. I appreciate, like I said, this stuff ain't luck. It's the grind speaks for itself, man. So, you know, anybody that I feel like, you know, you out there working hard and putting all your hard work into something, man, you know, eventually it's going to become. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I mean, definitely. Some of the songs that you got circulating, you know, around the turf. And I mean, songs like, you know, you got Bands with King Kodak. You got I Hustle with Timo the Great and Young Hustle. I mean, you got a lot of stuff out there, man. I mean, I guess for our listeners, you know, how did you get started in the game? What inspired you to rhyme and to really pursue it full time?
Well, you know, I was a young guy out there. I was playing basketball like that. And then the music was always my thing because I got an uncle that's out there right now doing time in jail, you know, fighting life. You know what I'm saying? Been down since I was a youngster, but he inspired me to really do music. He was one of the first people I seen about to get signed, you know, that's in the family. And then I had a cousin, you know, from Long Beach. You know, my uncle from, like, you know, Washington area, but I had a cousin from Long Beach, you know. He used to run around with Goldie Lowe, you know, from the East Side, you know what I'm saying? And,
yep.
You know, he kept me on that on that music, you know, because every time I come around, he's doing his music and take me to the studio. And so I just knew in me, it's like, you know, this is something I wanted to do. So I taught myself how to write music when I was about like 7 or 8, just create my own format and never ask for help and just try to create my own bar game and all that, you know. And, you know, that was the people that inspired me, you know what I'm saying?
What was one of the first things you ever wrote? Like what was like one of the first topics? Do you remember?
I came from my whole spiritual background, like with my music. I always was one of them dudes. I never wanted to do the real West Coast, you know, Crip thing and all of that. Cause, you know, so I came out with my music was more about, you know, God and the spiritual thing, you know, a life. But what happened was, you know,
you was a gospel rapper.
Yeah, you know, I was coming out like that. So pretty much what happened was, you know, the streets was like, man, you know, give them yourself, you know. We know, give them a little bit of your background when you was growing up, you know what I'm saying? You know, that type of life, you know what I'm saying? So I had to just transition, you know, in the music world because the listeners, you know, out there wasn't really listening to all the positive rap, you know what I'm saying? So I figured, I said, you know what, I'm going to have to just give them a whole nother format. So I said, I'm going to give you the hard West Coast beats and create my own format and still give you what I want to tell you and give you my message, but give you in the form of the West Coast world. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely. Mm-hmm.
Really? And that seemed like it worked for you, too. We appreciate hearing you.
Oh, man, it's all about it. Like I said, I wanted to get these kids something different than everybody else, you know what I'm saying? Give them some nutrition, something they can take home and build with and learn, you know what I'm saying, and grow with.
So let's follow on with that story that you laid out. Oh, my bad, T. Let's follow on because you got a nice little dialogue going on, you know. So what happened next? Like, did you jump on the stage and do any talent shows or do any shows for, like, your school or anything like that?
You know, well, yeah, I always was a performer since, like, elementary. You know, I always was a dude that stayed on the stage, you know, talent shows and all of that. My mom and pops always supported me, was always in the audience. And so, you know, it just kind of like running the family too. My pops is a singer, you know, they had a group when they was young. So it was just kind of running the family. And I just kept grinding. I was young out there doing performances and, you know, and after the show, I get kicked out because I'm young and under the age. And, you know, I was opening up for like Crooked Eyes and Warren G's and all these dudes before, you know, before they knew who I was.
They kicked you out because you was too young.
Yeah. You know, because you know, them clubs is 21 and
over. Okay.
Yeah, I've been grinding out here on these stages and doing all that, passing up deals and all that, man. So yeah, I wanted to do the independent rap.
Definitely.
That kind of makes me, I was going to ask you this question later, but since you brought all of that up, how did you link up with Snoop and his relaunch, and how long have you been around him in the game as far as after you grew up, apparently?
Yeah, I was trying to build towards that, Chilla. I was trying to build towards that. He just went straight for the gusto. Like, I was trying to build towards it. We got so much time.
We're going to fresh it up, though. See, what we do here, this is not our standard industry question. We freshen things up here. So we got it. We got it under control.
Okay, let's go and flow with it. Let's go.
Okay, so what was the question?
How did you end up linking up with Snoop now and with the relaunching part of it all, since, you know, you mentioned that as you were growing up, you know what I'm saying, you couldn't get into the clubs and do what you wanted to do, how you wanted to do it with Warren G and them. How did you end up linking up with Snoop now?
You know, pretty much, you know, I was out there grinding. Name was, you know, stay ringing for years. So pretty much it was, the city, we had something going on in the city. Stuff was looking like it was about to get real negative out there. So Snoop wanted to kind of like pull together the East, the West, and the North together on a more positive note, you know, on a more, you know, togetherness. So he reached out to a few cats that he felt that had that pull in the city, and me being one of the guys that got a lot of pull in my city, you know, he reached out to me being a young cat. And I have the young guys, and I got the older cat. So I just came in that zone around that time, and then pretty much he wanted to put a project together. So as we was coming the city down, making history with the East, North, and the West, which had never happened, you know what I'm saying, dealing with the gangs and all of that stuff out there, we just created some history and put all this stuff together. I reached out to the cats I knew on the West Side, on the North, and that they couldn't reach out to, and we just put all this stuff together, you know, and just created a good foundation for positivity, you know what I'm saying, positive artists out there. That's not really positive, but I'm saying that whole aspect of putting the whole city together on one note, you know what I'm saying?
Because, you know, a lot of people got the gangster stories, or we was chilling in the streets. Not to say that y'all didn't do all of that eventually, but the fact that y'all hooked up on a positive note, that's real cool. Because, you know, like I said, a lot of rappers, they tend to glorify the dirt that they did together, or some beef or some gangster that pulled them together. But the positivity is what pulled y'all together. That's real.
Yeah, because Snoop wanted to, you know, how he felt about the situation. He like, you know, what his generation of time was going through should have nothing to do with us in our time of growing up on the West Coast or in Long Beach, you know, so to say.
That's weird.
Definitely. Now, Zeke, in terms of what you mentioned earlier, in terms of when you said Crip specifically, for our listeners that may not know, and you can definitely attest to this, Long Beach is the only city in L.A., you know, South Central, you know, part of that whole territory that actually
California
is all Crip.
California.
That's the only city that has no Bloods in it at all. It's all Crip. And, you know,
yeah.
You got the 60s, you got the 20s, you got the Insane.
No 60s in Long Beach.
Okay, no, that's 60s. That's something going down towards Crenshaw, correct?
Yeah.
Okay,
Long
all right,
Beach,
right.
Long Beach, we got 20 Crips, which is where Snoop from. We got the Insane Crip, which is where Trady from. And I'm his younger homie. I'm the younger generation of the Insane and all that.
We
got the West Coast Crip that we don't, you know, the East Side really didn't get along with, and we got the North Side gangs, which was like the Two Winds and, you know, Mac Mafia's Old Hood, and the list continues. But the whole situation, we never all got together. We all was fighting against each other, and you know, all the negativity. You know what I'm saying? So I just love being a part of a positive situation, knowing where I come from. And I was one of them hard heads out there, and a lot of kids out there in the game, you know what I'm saying, out there in the streets used to look up to me. So I know if they looking up to me, I just knew I just had to take another route if they looking up to me and I'm out here pushing a positive entity. You feel me?
Definitely.
And that's always so, especially for the youth. You know, that's
definitely
good for the youth. It has something to look up to. Like, do you guys, like, when it comes to, since you want to build on positivity, do you guys basically have, like, youth centers or whatever the case may be to help kids out? Like, when it comes promoting your brand?
Yeah, we got recreational centers and stuff like that out there. So, you know, that's pretty much where everything go down at, the recreational centers, where you can go get that help, you know, your after-school programs and all of that type of stuff. Pretty much, I'm a freelancer, man. I move around and I just do the work off of my speech and, you know, talking to people that I see out here that probably need help. You know what I'm saying?
And that's real vital, you know, because these kids definitely need something to do after they get home from school. Now, not every kid, let's really be real, not every kid is going to want to come home straight from school and do homework and all. It just is what it is. You know, because after a while, they're going to get bored or whatever. They're going to need some activities or whatever to keep their mind occupied instead of going down the streets and getting the gun.
Yeah, exactly. You know, when you got too much idle time, man, something else will pop up. Especially if you are, you know, a lot of these people out here ain't got no goals in life. So that's the biggest thing I tell the kids, you know, you're growing up out here, you're doing your thing, make sure you create a goal. So, you know, that'll keep you out of trouble.
True that.
Definitely.
Do you see like any improvement going on in Long Beach?
Say it again, bro.
Yeah, you said you had. You see like any improvement in terms of, you know, the politics, the economics going on in Long Beach? Because it was like, you know, we heard a lot of like about with the crime and stuff like that, but you see a lot of that going down, like, you know, dwindling.
Oh man, you know, one thing about the cycle of genocide, man, I'm gonna say one thing about that is a cycle. So either you gon', you know, either you gonna wake up or not. So to ask your question, you know, it's still stuff that goes on, but it ain't got way better. I can say it like that.
That's what's up.
You know, got way better, man. And the economics and all that, you know, we still need to come together as a people and get more businesses. And that's the step we taking a step towards right now in Long Beach, knowing that that's a big part of owning your community and owning your own stuff. You know what I'm saying? In order to survive out here and don't get pushed out.
Definitely. Now, in terms of you, you know, not only being a rapper, an MC, definitely, and being a dope, you know, dope MC, there's a lot of times, you know, we talk about it all the time on the show about how so many artists come in the game, but they don't do their due diligence, they don't have the discipline, they don't study the craft, the culture, the art of composition, and the deadly art of rhyme in order to make it hot. What was the biggest thing you learned as you made your evolution in terms of really going from novice to pro? And, you know, what advice would you give to artists? Because we see so many artists, especially in this day and age of the microwave internet age, where everybody just jumps in and, like, shit is just supposed to be a hit off of a gimmick, but it doesn't have genuine talent. You know, that's obviously not the case with yourself because you got tons of it. But, you know, what's your view on a lot of niggas who try to jump in it and really just look at it for instant fame but not trying to add to the game?
I tell them, you know, you can't just hop in a mansion or just build a mansion in one day. You know, everything starts with a foundation. So once you start with a foundation, as you build up that foundation, you know, you'll learn. You learn in the midst when you learn in between as you growing through the, you know, going through the phases. So there ain't nothing overnight. You know, I've been in the music thing for over 16, 17 years. So it's really about what you want in it, you know, because it, you know, some people just want to get in the game just for a rap deal. You know, if that was my case, I could have been did that a long time ago. Some people want to go independent. So I tell a lot of artists nowadays, man, you know, to survive in this game, especially in 2018, being independent, you know, even being in the pros, you have to establish some type of brand, brand where you can stand out and be your own boss, you know what I'm saying, instead of having somebody else be your boss, you know, be your own man, you know, stand up for your own, go out there. You know, if you only got no help, go out there and do it yourself until you create your team. You know, a lot of these artists out there that's big, they're not just signing these regular artists, you know, saying that's out there. You have to grind and get your name buzzing to where it's kind of like you got to already have all your stuff together before you get signed, get that big deal. You know, they don't want to have to come fix you up and, you know, write your rhymes for you now and dress you in. you gotta be prepared. You gotta be a mogul out here. You gotta be on a move every day.
Have the majors ever gotten at you yet? Like, you had any like major labels contact you and you want to do deals?
Oh yeah, trust me. I had my first situation. Yeah, I had a look. We had a big look from Rockefeller back in the days when I was young, when they were still rocking stuff and all that. And but you know, I didn't even take time. You know, I was big headed back then, man. So I passed that stuff up. We had some folks hitting us up about 50 Cent and wanted us to come down and sit down, holler at 50 Cent. You know, we didn't make it to that meet. It was a certain stuff, you know, that kept pushing me towards just staying independent.
Damn, those are two big ass offers though. Like you said, yeah, you got man, offered Rockefeller when they was popping, and G Unit when they was popping.
Yeah,
the Knicks and the Bulls.
Word. Hey, no, not the Knicks.
They,
I mean,
and they prime.
The Bulls and the Lakers.
Yeah, you know, one thing about it with me was like, if these people was reaching out to me, evidently they reaching out to me for something I got, for something they see in me. So why not just hold it down?
Definitely,
you know?
Definitely.
That's where my head was.
So do you have any regrets for any of the decisions you made as far as signing the deals, not signing the deals? Do you have any regrets? Would you wish that you would have?
Look, I'll be telling artists this too. I say, you know, my younger years, I wish I probably would have tried to, you know, probably would have went on a route with the Rockefeller, or at least went on an adventure and see what it was going to unravel, because I had some years to probably play with when I was younger, you know. So, like, if I'm talking to younger artists, I would say, yeah, you know, you're young, you out there 16, 17, you probably got three to 5 years to kind of mess around with and get some experience out there in the game. You know what I'm saying?
I ain't gonna lie though, you probably did make the right decision, because a lot of motherfuckers that was down on Rockefeller nowadays, they really not, you know, not. It's like it's a downfall. Like, we can all agree on that. So you probably did make the right decision.
I don't think Dame would test on these cats from Long Beach like that, though. He know who he pressed,
no.
Not pressed.
Hey, you know
but
what?
You figure.
Dame Dash, too. Dame Dash a cool cat, man. I met him, you know, I used to ghostwrite for Dr. Dre's son, man. So we was in the lab and all that. He came in there. He was up there with, what's the other boy name? Man, I
Freeway?
Forgot his name.
Freeway?
Whoop.
Freeway?
Whoop. Yeah,
no, not
Freeway.
Not Freeway. I forgot his name, man. But anyway, he was solid, man. I like his style. The things I pick up from dudes like Dan Dash is, you know.
Oh, you talking about the dude? I know who you're talking about. I forgot his name.
Jim Jones.
He a Harlem cat. Jim Jones. Yeah.
Jim Jones,
they came
okay.
up there. They came out here to Hollywood, man, with the whole camp. And, you know,
okay,
now one thing
okay.
I like about that whole camp, they look like they always eating. That's what I respect about them. Even the security, everybody was eating.
Okay.
That must have been when they had that joint venture with Vamp Life. Jim Jones
yeah.
and this dude.
Dame.
Dame
Dash. They had a clothing line. Yeah, they had a clothing line.
Yeah, Vamp Life.
Yeah. I mean, but definitely, man. I mean, you look at it, you know, everything happens for a reason in terms of, you know, like you said, why you didn't sign the deals, this, that, and the other. Because definitely even Rockefeller now, as we know it, doesn't exist anymore, technically. You know, as Jay, you know, Jay went on to Rock Nation with it. But definitely, Zeke, I got to put you right up in the pantheon of the four top MCs on the West Coast. And shout out to all of y'all. In no particular order, you know, Nipsey Hussle, because of what he did with Victory Lap. Oh my God,
incredible!
I
still gotta hear
yeah.
that
all
shit.
Respect to that cat, man, right there, man.
Yeah, shout out to the '60s and what he represent. Of course, Compton AV, you know, he's another young gunner. You know, yourself, of course, and Compton and AD. You know, out of Compton as well. To me, y'all are the four that have really just, you know, the new, you know, just keeping the gangsta out west, man, for the L.A., man. I mean, y'all, I mean, y'all keep doing it, man, please. Cause,
I think you forgot to mention Slim 400, too.
Slim 400, yeah. TTD, you know what I'm saying?
Slim 400, you know. Let's go, my boy Compton Menace. Shout out to my boy Compton Menace. He's another grinder out here cracking.
Yeah.
You know, them names you pretty much you said, man. I'm looking around and You know, this is the same name that's popping up all day, man, out here, man. So that's it. That's pretty much.
Can I back up what you said just a minute ago, just for 1 second, because I think you kind of threw it in there and just blazed over it real quick. You said you were a ghostwriter for Jason, correct? Or you did some ghostwriting for Jason?
Yeah, y'all did a little ghostwriting for Dr. Dre's son, yeah.
Curtis okay, Young. So who else have you been a ghostwriter for? Can you name just a few?
Oh, no. That's pretty much, that's all I was putting out there. You know what I'm saying? I done worked with a lot of other artists, you know. One thing about this game is, like I learned from Snoop, me and Snoop don't work together, and Snoop done took some of my words, and while we doing the music, and we vice versa. So I learned something from Snoop. You know, I used to be big headed about, you know, taking somebody else's words and all of that extra stuff like that. But pretty much when you're working together, it's like steel sharp as steel, man. We all working towards making a platinum song. So that's pretty much what it was, you know.
Right. Definitely. Now, Zeke, in terms of the West Coast, because y'all have always stayed true to your roots, I just want to get your opinion of it, because for what Game's album did, you know, when he dropped the documentary in 2005 that really, you know, brought the West Coast back, how big was Nipsey's album in terms of really getting the exposure back for y'all, in terms of really showing that the West still has fire, not only has fire, but can come with classics to people? You know, this day and time, we just see so many of the listening public, so much of the listening public that is inundated with what is put out in the mainstream, that is just like, this is what's fashionable, but it's not what's really fresh, you know. And any of my co-hosts will tell you, you know, I've always been a West Coast fan, still am. And, I've always wanted to see the West Coast really get the respect it deserves for the MCs that come from there, because there are so many of y'all. How big was the Nipsey album in terms of really showing what y'all have?
Oh, man, I think he deserved 10 stars on that joint. You know what I'm saying? Nipsey, you know, I go off the whole image. You know what I'm saying? Nipsey out here putting out some good music. Not only good music, you know, he a good example of an independent artist. So
definitely,
you know, so I like the mixture of both. You know what I'm saying? He's not no dumb guy out here. So, you know, and that's pretty much the stuff that my energy and my image I'm out here putting out here, you know, also similar to something he's doing. You know what I'm saying? You know, we from the streets and all that, but you know, you could be from the streets and still be educated, you know, in the game.
Definitely. Now, sitting down in terms of when you realized this was for real, in terms of when you knew this was a career for you, you know, putting together mixtapes, songs, and everything, what goes into your, you know, creative writing process in terms of how you decide what you want to go with? Because, and I'll get to the next part of it later, but I wanted to get into your train of thought about when you get into that car of, you know, concentration. What's a writing session like for you in terms of when you decide what you want to put out there?
Man, pretty much I just, you know, I tap in with the universe. I smoke a little bit of this herb from the earth, you know, and that's what I do. You know, I like to get real comfortable, but as the music going, you know, I just go off of what's real, man. I like going off of what's real. What can I grab the people with? You know what I'm saying? How can I relay a message in this song? You know, not just, you know, right there in the open, but how can I put a message in here and still get the same effect from a dope song that it could be about trap and whatever. That same type of energy, but get this message through these kids and through the world, to the world. You know what I'm saying? So that's where my creative thought process go in, to where, you know, I make it to where, you know, I can't have a rapper just thinking, oh, he just came up with this so easy. So it's just like this is like a biblical story. You know what I'm saying? Everything I write, I feel like it's already written. It's already written. It's already out there already. So all I'm doing is just filling in the shoes and the time and the space.
Right.
What were some lessons that you learned in working with Snoop in the studio?
A few lessons I learned from Snoop. One of them, like I was saying, you can always get some good advice from another artist, or you know, if you know whatever gonna help out the situation on the track. Another one was just keeping good energy, you know, keeping that love and that good energy, that good vibe up in the studio. And that's very important when you're being an artist, jumping studio to studio. You got to, you know, pretty much get that good producer, that good vibe to keep your stuff going. And, shoot, that's pretty much what I learned from Snoop, you know what I'm saying? And just don't rush no tracks. You know, take your time, build on them joints.
And definitely, in terms of what you said earlier about, you know, where you were writing more of the gospel-oriented rap, you know, and that's always been, you know, for a lot of people, you know, from generations, you know, from older generations to the new, and people who really don't understand the beginnings of rap music, that it came from the streets. You know, we all believe in a higher power. We all love our creator, you know, and definitely. But I think a lot of times people... One, you know, people got to understand, too, that it's kind of hard to blend it from something that is considered to be the more holier aspects and then bring in, you know, the streets, because they're so distinctly different in, you know, how, you know, the mess, you know, what comes up in it. I don't think a lot of people really have, I don't think it's an issue where people don't love God. I think it's about how can you really put something good into it where it appeals to everybody, you know, because the hardcore aesthetic of hip hop is still street rooted, and for people it is a reflection. It's black people seeing it. It's really reflecting what goes on, and what goes on ain't always pretty, you know. What's your opinion of that?
That's pretty much true. We're just going off of what we see, what we heard,
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying, what we can grab, what we can taste, you know what I'm saying, just off of this regular senses. So that's pretty much, you know, where all of this, the music and all of this stuff come into this ball of energy, you know what I'm saying? I would like to say a ball mm-hmm. of energy, because this is what happens, you know, it's an evolution. So all we're doing is just speaking a story. You're just telling the story. That's all it is, you know.
Okay.
And that's all I do.
I'm glad I'm glad you touched on evolution, because now you've been in the game for about a good 16, and you've seen that the business model has, you know, shape-shifted in a lot of ways. Like, you know, you don't even see actual labels no more. You see downsizing. You see studios being swallowed up and all this stuff, and everything is basically moved into micromanaging and basically streaming. So how you keep touch with your base in terms of those changes?
Yeah, well, as me, like I say, you know, me being an independent artist, I jumped off into the just being the artist side. I was just into the artist side. So as me transitioning to my business, this is years down, but like 3 years ago when I first started really like, okay, I need to start really get my business all the way tightening up my business, you know what I mean? Because one thing about artists, we'll fall into our hobby all day until it's time to pay a bill. Try to pay that bill, it's like, damn, all right, now it's the end of the
year. Number one.
How you gonna get them dollars?
Word.
Definitely.
It turns into like a all night party session. It'd be like those 94, 95 Death Row sessions. The next thing you know, they hit you with that bill. The next day, you like, okay. What do we do here?
It gotta add up. You know, the time you're putting in, Some stuff got to add up. You know, there's a lot of artists that want a free verse, or they want this and they want that. And here it is. They're not even paying their way. You know, they ain't even that confident because they, you know, they just trying to ride a boat, man. And to be honest, like I said, this stuff, the illusion of this industry, you know, it'll get a lot of people toe up, man. They'll think, well, I can have this in a year or two. And when you got to grind, man, you got to grind. It's all about
especially when it comes to young kids. Especially when it comes to the young artists. The young artists be looking at their rap idols, you know, splashing all this money, all the women, the cars, whatever, and they think they can just get that shit by just writing a couple of songs. Sometimes it actually works. Like, once in a blue, you do have them motherfuckers that just started rapping yesterday, and they have a platinum hit. But that money's not going to them.
That's true. That is true. Look, Sam, man, how many times have we heard those stories about artists that were broke after they had a platinum song because their business was not taken care of?
A billion. You heard of a billion? I say a billion.
Hey, but you know, I'm gonna tell you.
Yeah, that shit every day.
I'm gonna say one thing about that. A ruler go from 0 to 12, so you do have to go through them inches and learn. You got to get play with that fire and get burnt and learn not to play with that fire. So it's It's learning experience.
That's one thing.
Like I said, I done got work.
Everybody's gonna get jerked.
Everybody's
gonna get jerked.
But that's the part of paying your dues in the game. I just took it as paying my dues and knowing what to do and not to do now.
Right. Trial and error.
That's it.
Definitely.
Trial and error.
Before we go further, I got just one question. We asked a little bit, but when you're talking about the grind, has the internet helped your grind, or is your grind still more on the street level? You putting them in store, like how do you utilize the internet, and is that a like major portion of how you grind your songs and your music?
I say the internet is cool, just keeping your face out there, just you know, promoing and all that. But, you know, they done blew that internet world up so big. And, you know, the internet world is cool, but the real life, the old ways of things, the old ways of communicating is always the best to me. I'm still out here on the grind, the hand-to-hand, the, you know, passing words, you know, the word and all that. I'm old school on the grind. So I do both of them. I do both of them. I balance both of the world.
I hear that shit.
Some more copies of the mixtapes. Hand over fist.
Uh-huh.
Oh yeah, we coming.
Yeah,
we got some shit dropping. So y'all stay tuned. We got some shit coming for sure. For sure.
Definitely. Now Zeke, you know we gotta. You know, on Off the Cuff Radio, we always pride ourselves on being the CNN of the internet radio. So we gotta ask you definitely some serious questions as well. You know, another serious question. You're from the city, you know, LBC. We know about All Blue out there, and we know how real that gang lifestyle is. And we've seen a lot of rappers over the years who are not from L.A., you know. And, of course, there are gangs all over the country that are legitimately, you know, got connections. But we've also seen a lot of these guys come in who ain't got connections and try to act like they do got connections. We know a lot of your homeboys and your homegirls died over colors. What is your opinion of a lot of these rappers coming in playing? We don't want to put no names out there, but we all know who we all know, you know, when we watch.
Man, it's too much names to even name.
I just say like this.
Ditto that Sandman. Yeah, what's your opinion of a lot of these rappers that are playing with this shit with colors that really don't understand what it really means, whether you blood, cripple, pyro? You know, what's your opinion on that?
I think them dudes is buffoons, man, out here playing the game, you know? You know, they setting themselves, a lot of these artists setting up themselves for failure. You know, a lot of people where I come from, they lived that life. They trying to live a whole nother life now. They lived that life. It's like, to me, right. It looks like they're going backwards. You know, they think that you need that recognition through the games and all that to be some type of hard guy or whatever and get some record sales. But really,
right.
You know, you're pretty much just putting a lot of problems on yourself. It's, you know, and clubs ain't going to probably want your ass in a minute because you're going to be bringing problems to the club. Who want an artist that's going to come out, every time they come out, the club is getting shot up because there's a negative person in this place. And they just trying to, you know, they trying to get to that ass. it ain't working, you know. It ain't working. And then they sending out the wrong waves to the next generation of hip-hop artists and talented people that's coming up in the game.
It's like CB4 comes to life.
Exactly. And why CB4 did that? CB4 did that shit for money and bitches. And it's the same thing with motherfuckers doing that shit now. You know, these so-called rappers perpetrating to be gang members. It's all for the money and the bitches. You know,
yeah,
like, you know, chicks love, you know, chicks love their tough guys.
Yeah, it's just all watered down now, man. I was born in the 80s, grew up in the 90s, so I've seen a different lifestyle out here on the West Coast. You know, from actually hard dudes, you know, they were, you know, out here, they wasn't tolerating no snitches and shit and all that stuff back in the day. You know, the shit been so
hell no.
It's just
nowadays that shit is accepted.
It's just normal. You know what I'm saying?
Accepted,
you know,
to be a rat.
Come on, man. You know, yeah. I can't say nothing about nobody, man. Do y'all thing out there, but. At the same note, they bringing a lot of problems to their self because a lot of that shit's a narrative.
Definitely.
And
it's funny,
too,
you know.
I think, too, is that they also believe that their money makes them feel more untouchable. They figure, hey, I could just step down in the city. I just spread some of this money around. I buy the set some new cars. I pay some car notes and put some rent on the OG's commission, and I'd be okay. When that money slow up,
yep. Money can't buy a real person, man. At the end of the day, you know.
That's good.
Money can't buy that real person. So, you know, it always go back to that energy. Whatever you putting out, man, is what you're gonna get back. So, if you as an artist want to put out that negative image, that negative vibe, man, don't be surprised if the Reaper catches you.
Man.
Right, and can I just say one example of what y'all are all talking about? I speak about this all the time. Of course, last week I spoke about it, but utilizing Cardi B as an example, she was on top. She's still on top, probably. She had the number one Billboard song on the Billboard, all of that. I think a simple mistake that she made, but something that apparently she doesn't think is a mistake as far as talking about the set that she loves or whatever the fact. That, I think, was a detrimental to her career in the sense that I saw a lot of people saying, damn, I love Cardi B up until that bullshit. Like, something as simple as why you gonna go on social media and rep in a way that you don't have to rep. And nobody was after her. That was dry beef in my mind. That was some dry beef shit. She could have said anything else.
Cardi B? You know what it is with Cardi B? Like, she's like, it's normal that she says dumb shit. I always said that shit ever since. I was like, she just needs to stick to doing her music, stay off of Twitter, stay off of Snapchat, all that extra Instagram, all that. Because she would sit there and try to basically be smart or basically try to give somebody some advice or whatever. First of all, her fucking voice is cringeworthy. Second of all, it's like, oh my goodness. I can just go on and on.
She came up off of that type of clout, though. She came up off the drama, you know? That was her route. Figure that's her route. You know, some of these people feel like that is their route. if people looking in, whether it's good or bad publicity, it's still publicity to these guys. So they're like, hey, let's keep doing it. I know this is a soft spot, so they're going to keep hitting that soft spot, and everybody going to be regular-ass trolls and continue egging this stuff on. You know, it's just some movie shit. It's just smoke screens.
And you're not, yeah, you're not lying about that,
like,
but when people are starving for drama, they just need to pick what kind of drama they want. It's one thing to be messy and be a messy female and talk shit and all that, but once you start hitting party lines and crossing over into some gangster shit, then that's when you start creating a world of trouble, and not just for you, your dude that you think gonna step in and have your back. That right there, there should be a boundary on what you do for publicity. That's just my opinion.
I mean, if they don't, you know, if they don't see what already happened in history with Pac and, you know, and Biggie, and, you know, looking at already what's already written in history, I mean, what can you say? But, you know, it's a lot of dumbasses out here, man.
For real.
And definitely, and you know, Zeke, that's real what you said, you know. And the fact is, you know the history like I know the history, that, you know, there is, you know, real bloods in New York, you know, OG Mac Drama, for our listeners that may or may not know the history of him, you know, punch it up on, you know, Bing, and you can read the whole story about him. So New York does have real blood roots. I think with Cardi, with that situation, you know, Cardi is a real banger, you know, Washington Heights. But that was a situation where, for where Cardi's fame as celebrity is right now, I don't think that was something she really needed to put out there. Like Chinchilla said, that's why it really, really raised the problem, because unless you were really in the street or you knew her history, you knew that. But that's something, I think, for Cardi, she didn't need to put that out there. You know, it's like, ooh, you're doing good right now. You know, you don't...
Yeah.
There are people, you don't,
it's
yeah,
basically
you don't need to
what
let
we built
know
on.
That.
Yeah, it's like what we built on from before. Where, like, you know what I'm saying? When you're a brand, you're not supposed to be out there, you know, gun
exactly.
running or whatever the case may be. Like, you're a brand
yeah.
now. You're supposed to have the wolves out there taking care of that shit for you, if anything. You're not supposed to get your hands dirty, because you get your hands dirty, the whole brand collapses.
Exactly.
For real, and he's not even warned Snoop about that shit when he gave him that money. Nigga, you can do what you do, but you want to lead the gangs out of it, or your money's going to dwindle at some point eventually. It's, I mean, like you said, like everybody said on the panel, history has already been written, and if you don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it, but you don't have to be a dumbass. You can be a drama-filled female, whatever, but nigga, just watch
yeah.
it. Because she was already
talking about it. She's
not fun being extorted.
You know, I'm one of the young pioneers right here on the West Coast, where, you know, I helped create a Blood and Crip movement out here. So I couldn't fall for nothing like that, because, you know, I took time. Like I said, there was a lot of people that was against me out here that didn't think it was possible. You know, I got around some young cats, and one of my guys that's from the Dog Crew Entertainment, my boy Young Mike West. He from the red side, you know what I'm saying?
Mm.
I was from the blue side, so we always had a vision of showing, like I said, showing the youth that it was something different. And then it just took a few years to show, you know, it actually can work. And so we brought together the red and the blue out here, and I actually, you know, we actually went out, Snoop and them was doing their stuff, and we ended up hitting the paper with Farrakhan and all that. So that was a good thing. That was a peaceful movement right there.
What it is.
And that's real, because that's what I was talking about the last time we spoke about it. The fact that people are trying to bring, because I was thinking of the Snoop and I think it was Snoop and Game that they were talking about and what y'all were doing. At the end of the day, when everybody's trying to move towards positive thinking between the gangs and trying to keep a truth going and not trying to rile up some gang bullshit, this is the worst time with our country going through what it's going through. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
for her
exactly.
to pull out that. She could have repped her set. She could have said whatever she wanted, but it was just a disrespectfulness adding the F. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, it was just, why would you want to spark gang beef when there's no reason to, and you needed no extra publicity? So it just confused the shit out of me why she did this. I just don't understand.
Well,
Plus, on top of that, like, you're on Rolling Stone. You don't want to mess up that white folk money like that. Now, they could be like, I don't know, we're going to put you on there now.
Exactly.
Yeah, she was just, you know, I don't know what to say about her, but I just say, you know, it must have been, she was in her old zone, man. Let me just say that.
Yeah.
Sometimes we still got the street in us, man. So sometimes it's just like she must have went back to a phase, man, back in her old days or something, you know. And God forgive, you know what I'm saying? We all should, you know. It ain't nothing I'm going to hold nothing against her or nothing like that. Because a lot of these people out here make mistakes and all that, man. And, you know, you slip up and say one thing wrong and we going to hate you. And really, you're probably a good person, you know.
And in her defense, she did take that thing down. She, on Instagram, she did revise that whole shit and take that message down. So, I mean, I think she saw what happened and it was a mistake after the fact. I don't think she wanted to
put some
bullshit.
I seen her talking to Dick Snoop, so when, you know, I was like, okay, you know, everything is getting leveled out.
Yeah, Snoop is the peacemaker. It seems like he got to squash all this.
Man. Snoop. One thing about Snoop Dogg, man. One thing I learned about him is all positive around him. It's always love. One thing about him. Every time I come around him, he always got a smile. He always so hard. And it looks so easy. But this dude will never stop. He worked like he just now jumped back in the game. Like he just started over. Like he worked hard. So to be in that position.
He walk on walls, and this is for all his dogs.
Hey, I salute to the dogs. Like I said, I seen his work ethic, man. And it's, you know, it's unstoppable, doggy. And that's the type of dude I like to have in my corner to keep me pushing and going forward. Knowing it ain't no time to slow up, man. Even 20 years in the game, 20-something years after, you know, still pushing like you just jumped in the game. If you want to have that name in the game and be a legendary, you got to have that work ethic.
We talked about that class of Long Beach veterans, and I seen that you was also on Daz's album, and what was it like working with him?
Oh, yeah, man. Hey, it was a blessing. He hit me up, man, and, you know, I jumped on the track. But, you know, working with Dash, he's a real person. I mean, he's a real solid dude. You know, he got his foot in the game and his foot in the street, and he's just showing you hands on, like, independently go all the way in. He dropped 30 tracks on that thing, you know. Now go ahead and go cop that thing, that Dazzle My Tab, you know. I got a single on there called Show Some Respect with Kokane. Kokane, Daz, and me on that joint.
Shout out to Kokane not too long ago, so big shout out to him as well.
Definitely.
Yeah, man. Kokane got more features than anybody in the hip hop game, man. He hit the record.
He's a standard bearer, man. You know, when we had him on the show, we interviewed him, and you know, it was one of the best shows we've ever done. You know, shout out to Kokane and Anissa Long, man. You know, his daughter.
Shout out the whole Pomona. You know what I'm saying? The whole LBC movement, the Pomona movement, Carson movement. You know, every movement out there doing their thing and staying positive and staying on the grind, man.
Definitely, definitely. This is Off the Cuff Radio. We are here with Young Zeke along with the Guillotine. Call number is 1-619-924-0703. And editor's note, what I said earlier about the, you know, about the Blood Nation in New York, I should have... It's editor's note is OG Mac, not OG Mac Drama. Those are two specifically different individuals, just so our listeners, you know, don't get them crossed up. But OG Mac is the guy who is credited with starting, you know, the Blood Nation in New York. He's that guy, not Mac Drama, OG Mac. Okay, just had to correct
there
that.
There you go. There you go. And if you want to call up the show, just you got to remember, you got to press 1 so I can see you and I can plug you on. If you have any businesses you want to plug, you have any artists you want to plug, you want to get on the show and, you know, freestyle, who knows? Maybe you can get heard and get signed on the Dogghouse. I mean, anything's possible. So feel free to chop it up.
Definitely.
Yeah, I wanted to say, too, man, you know, I got my strain coming out. I got my own strain coming out called B-City OG.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, we working. You know, B-City OG, I named it after, you know, off of the single we had dropped with Snoop, that B-City song. So I just put the OG behind it, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I'm dropping that summertime. So y'all be on the lookout for that. That strain right there is actual clothing brand we, you know, we working on right now. I'm going to put out there. You know, I'm looking at some little movie scripts and all that other stuff too. So, you know, sky's the limit over here, man. I'm just working, showing that, you know, anything is possible.
Right, now that's a true example of evolution. Niggas used to all come out with their own shoe brands, their clothing line. These niggas is coming out with strains now. I'm just saying.
I said, forget it. Let me do something else. Let me be, you know, let me come with something different. You know, I like, you know, I'm a cannabis type of dude, you know, young Zeke Marley type of dude. So I said, why not? Let me go ahead and get my own strain. And I actually, you know, reached out to a few celebrities out there that ain't capable of grabbing a strain or whatever. And, you know, I got doors open for them, too. You know, they out there looking for strains and stuff like that. You know, shout out to my folks out there, Uplifted Farms. You know, we out there working. My other production company I mess with, TXX Production. You know, shout out to the whole team, man. I'm out here working.
Man,
I'm going to
work goddamn. But I'm just playing Harris County. I was just playing. I'm a good little girl.
Oh, sure.
Definitely.
Yeah, and so you have a project coming out this year? Like a mixtape or album?
I got an EP coming out called God A, G-O-D-A, meaning greatest of them all. I was gonna drop that like the beginning of this month, but I might wait for 420 so we can just, you know, bang them out with the big cannabis smoke and all that.
Yeah, that's
you have any features on there?
Yeah, I got a few features on there. I got one of the features I got on there is my boy Compton Menace. I don't want to keep saying all the names. You know, I got to make sure everything is A1, but you know, mixed down, mastered, and make sure we picking these certain songs. But I want to say Compton Menace gonna be on there. I got the Twister track. Me and Twister just did a joint. We got a single, B-City OG is my B-City OG single. That joint right there is super crazy. See, I wait on that one right there. That's going to be super crazy. I got my dog crew members on that joint, you know. So, yeah, it's going to be a dope project.
So, are there any artists out there that you want to work with but haven't yet, or maybe that you want to work with that you've already worked with, you just want to work with again? Let us know something.
The only artist I really want to work with is artists just like myself, which, you know, on a hard grind. So I would say, like, I got to do a feature with the big homie one of these days, Big Trady. Want to do something with Trady. I want to do something with my boy Jadakiss. You know, them like my two dudes right there, Jadakiss. I got something that works real soon with Papoose.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are you bringing Pat back out of this? That's interesting.
Oh, yeah. And then for sure, I want to do something with Nipsey Hussle, man. Because we come from two different sides of the world. And I know for sure when we come together, man, it's going to be a great thing. Something bigger than us, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I can see that
yourself. Definitely.
We can't wait to see that one.
But it's definitely, you are the epitome of the DIY that has basically defined hip-hop culture, you know, and I think that's something that I think our listeners can all relate to and can learn from in terms of understanding that, you know, because when you look at the history of so many artists and, you know, people who, and moguls, you know, you look at Puffy, who was an intern, you know, before he made it. Nipsey was grinding like 15 years independently before he got his deal with Atlantic, and he had already went through a couple deals before then. You know, like you said, this shit don't happen overnight. You know, it takes time, it takes talent, it takes patience, it takes perseverance.
Persistence, all of it. You know,
yeah,
it takes a lot of concentration. So, and that's why, you know, I had to, you know, God A, it was basically like my alter ego, you know, G-O-D-A. So I created, you know, Greatest of Them All. I had that as an alter ego to where I know it takes the greatest of myself to become the greater me. You know what I'm saying? You gotta keep
right.
that focus. You got to tunnel. You gotta have that tunnel energy. You got that vision, and keep climbing up that mountain, man. Because it's gonna be a lot of obstacles, you know, from the street life, you know, from family, from you know, I lost a lot of people in my life. You know, rest in peace, and you know, from violence in the street to life in jail to so on and so forth. So it takes a strong mind, body, and soul to overcome everything in life to become the greater you.
That's true, man. Ain't that the truth? I mean, what's pretty much in terms of how, you know, where hip-hop is right now, where do you see it evolving to? You know, do you think we'll get back to the essence where it's really about the skills as opposed to sensationalized images? Or, you know, is it kind of, where do you see the evolution of our culture that we love so much, the music, going along with it?
I see it as more people taking that independent turn, not letting these bigger cats behind the scene, you know, control the radio and, you know, and what we got to hear. I figure we're going to make our own base, you know, and get back to the real essence of hip hop and the love of it, because it all started with the love of hip hop, you know what I'm saying, in the music game. You know, so we need, that's something I wanted to give back, kind of, you know, that energy of, you know, let's go get it, man. Let's go hustle. Let's go get it, you know. Have a smile on your face, you know. Keep that positive energy, man. The grind is good. You feel me?
Let's have positive mentors like Snoop giving you the game. And, you know, it's not sugar-coated. It's straight authentic. So that's where you know right there that you're headed through the right path.
Yeah, my other mentor, man, my first mentor, you know, before I linked with Snoop was my boy Ricky Harris, rest in peace.
Man,
you know,
shout out,
man. And, you know, rest in peace to my dude, man. It's crazy. But,
that
yeah.
That's a loss right there.
Yeah,
man,
bro.
Ricky was.
Yeah, man.
That dude was
still feeling it. That dude right there, man, he showed me, he just believes in me, bro. Not even believe, because I don't even believe in nothing. I know. He knew in me. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, just that little part right there, I was like, you know, I took that, I put that in my gas tank and said, you know, I gotta keep pushing for all of these people that's not here with me today. You know what I'm saying? So that's another something you could put behind you or put with you or have beside you, you know, add to your tank is all the stuff that's going on in your life. You know what I'm saying? And just adding it to the tank and just keep walking. Keep working hard. You know what I'm saying? And then
definitely.
You get there eventually, man. Trust me. And you keep praying on it. You know, just don't pray for something that you're not ready for, because God will reveal it to you as time comes.
Amen to that.
Real
so
right
we got
to
ask. Definitely. So we got to ask you. So Snoop is almost 50. How does he feel of being such a revered figure that he's like our uncle now? He's like all of our uncle. You know, it's like, you know, being such a distinguished influence. How does he feel that he is so appreciated, so loved, so respected in terms of, from, I mean, you saw the Death Row documentary like we all did, and and we saw everything he went through, and he's still here with us today. How does he feel in terms of just knowing that I survived all of this? Not only that, my people stayed with me the whole way.
One thing about Snoop, I'm gonna tell you, he don't be thriving off of like a lot of old stuff. One thing about him, he just say, keep pushing, get
mm-hmm.
it, keep loving. That's all, you know, keep loving. So, because what love do is open up more doors. You mean, you opening up hearts. You know, in this game, you want to build a fan base of people that actually like love your spirit, man. That's the difference. Not just the, you know, all your image, you know, the fake stuff, you know. No, that actually love your spirit. You know what I'm saying? So just spreading that good love out there. That's all he's pushing. You know.
Yeah, that's the power of that's the power of networking right there, because people don't understand that. You know, you bring that positive energy, it can open up those type of doors. Versus you come in with the ego or the chip on your shoulder. I mean, it may work for you in terms of knocking down certain doors, but sometimes you don't want to knock down too many doors, because you know you might need someone to open back up.
Yeah, because once the door closed, you know, this game don't come with no books. So you learn off experience. Man, a lot of, you know, but you can't have your animal instincts, you know, all on your, you know, like you said, chip on your shoulder, running around, you know. A lot of artists do that, though. I started off doing that. So I can't blame nobody if you start doing that. But, like you said, the doors don't close on you. And then I had to like, reinvent myself, you know what I'm saying, so to speak. I had to reinvent myself with the good energy. And like I said, and then after that, you know, more doors open for you, you know. And you ain't got to go through every door or none of that. You create your doors. You start creating your own doors. So... and that's where I'm at with it, you know. I create my existence, man. So that's what an artist or an independent artist should know about this game. You have to create your surroundings. You have to create that energy of good people, good fans, you know.
Well, one door that we can say for sure that he closed was the door between him and Trump, because he pissed Trump off, and I loved it.
I think he was doing that for the people. He was doing what he was supposed to do right there. He did that for the people.
That was one of the most gangster calls I've ever seen.
That
he remade the death certificate cover. It put Trump's name on the toe tag. That was one of the most gangster things I've ever seen.
Yeah, because his level was a gangster, man. And so, you know, evidently, Snoop, you know, he grew and he realized what the real gangsters is, man. You know what I'm saying? And that's a whole nother level of gangster. You feel me? Who gonna bark
well,
up those trees? A lot of people ain't gonna bark up those trees.
That's real talk.
Well, Snoop won't never scared. I mean, and anytime, you know, and I think definitely, you know, he's among many, I believe, in terms of rappers, you know, just in the hip-hop community who've always seen things in politics that wasn't correct. And, you know, when they had enough of it, they spoke up. I mean, we saw a couple years ago, you know, with YG, you know, and Nipsey, when they came together for FDT, and I think that spoke for a lot of us, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. And,
so that was...
Those are good waves, you know. I'm proud of all them type of dudes, man, that have been out here pushing that line, because, you know, I'm on a whole nother level of pushing those lines also. And
mm-hmm.
and they all recognize, you know, we all recognize. So we're just sending out those good waves, man. It's a whole nother time, and space. So, we're looking for the... We're looking to better our situation out here instead of make stuff worse for the next brothers and sisters out there.
And you also said you used to hoop back in the day. Now, I don't know if you follow the NBA closely, but who you think got it this year?
I'm going to tell you the truth, man. I stopped watching TV 12, 13 years ago.
Oh,
Lord. I'm a different type of dude, man. I don't, you know.
Oh, he cut the cable
I don't watch
before
TV.
Everybody cut
I don't,
the cable cord.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't watch TV. I don't do none of that, man. I just study and stay focused, man. I don't eat meat, none of that. I just eat fish and veggies. How you doing?
Hey, he lives a healthy lifestyle, man. Healthy lifestyle. You know, you heard us say that from the beginning of the show about, you know, and that's another thing too. Yeah, that's definitely. If I could ask you that too, in terms of the habits that you've seen a lot of artists have in terms of the
just give me a Dutch. I hear you. I'm in the store grabbing a Swiss.
But in terms of the habits that you've seen a lot of artists, because you definitely embody the essence of clean living. What is your opinion about the excess with some artists in terms of too much drinking, you know, too much smoking stuff that isn't the good lettuce from the ground? What's your opinion of that?
I go back off of are you welcome? I just say don't indulge too much, man. Just life is balance. If you don't have no balance, you will fail in anything.
Mm-hmm.
So I just say keep a balance, man. You know, I don't want to be nobody's mama or daddy, but you know, in order to survive out here, it's all about, you know, it's health, mental health, you know,
right?
Physical health, you know, every part of health.
Definitely.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what it do, man.
You know, and I appreciate y'all having me too, man. So, you know, I know my time is kind of real short. So, you know, shout out to the whole Cuff Radio, you know. The whole family up there, man. Hopefully to meet y'all one of these days, man, and continue
back
on.
For when you release that EP.
Oh,
yes,
man,
we will have it.
When I release, yeah. I release that joint.
We will have it in rotation.
Problems.
Yeah. Can we get some bread? Can we put him in the hot seat before we go? Is that possible?
You want to give
Why
us
not?
You want to give us a good 16?
I'm gonna give you something. This is for all the people right here. It's called Same Problem. From different hoods, though we locked behind the same bars. Picking at the same bar. We so alike, so we hustle for the same stack. Can't explain why every hood got hood rats. Watch the news, we the product of the same violence. Moms on welfare, pops with the same nonsense. We not the same, tell them same dude, stop lying. We got our differences, we living with the same problem. Most reddits on the block full of them gangsta sinning. End up throwing up that seal, that suwoo business. Where it's hard to get a job, streets we hustling in them. Cops hot in every hood, they be cuffing you in them. Same heart, quick to fade if you yap and get to wilding out. Same rule, keep your lips shut, attend the program. Pull a hammer, squeeze if the enemies come back around. Loyal to the fam, down from niggas from the same town. And it's a shame all the close homies resting now. Or doing life behind bars, trying to wiggle out. We see the same type of flicks, homies sending out. Swole because they on the pull-up dips and they running mouths. We fight the same type of struggle, what I will announce. Hustle for the kids, save for family in your own house. To do the math, we the product of the same violence. Hit the same shots, end it with the same sirens. From different hoods, so we locked behind the same bars. Break the same laws, drinking at the same bar. We so alike, so we hustle for the same stacks. Can't explain why every hood got hood rats. Watch the news, we the product of the same violence. Moms on welfare, pops with the same nonsense. We not the same, tell them same dude, stop lying. We got our differences, we living with the same problem. End up throwing chains to the homeless. Every time I bend the corner, same cops pull you over, smell like marijuana. With the different states, we got the same type of attitudes. Granny, make sure you say a prayer before you eat the food. Everything's soaking from the yams to the slow song. One person on the piano, somebody on the blowhorn. Same type of rhythm, dirty dancing on the dance floor. Get too aggressive, lady, tell you get your hands off. We look the same to the judge in the county blues. Our minds felt the same way. Paralyzed, couldn't move. Wipe the same tears, it was hard to see a son go. In the same system where they got you in the chokehold. I had a dream all so all my ex knows. Same type of dream, we all vision when your pocket broke. We got the same type of feeling about getting rich. We all got our differences, but living by the same script.
And I'm out of there, man. Dog Crew Entertainment, young.
Yeah.
Goodness, man. I was sitting there vibing.
Yes. Man, we appreciate that. Not only did he come with something, he came hard.
Okay. Man. That's
what
you're
talking about, man. I think we have a 412 call. Let me see if I can get this call right here.
Okay.
Yo, yo, what up? What's going on? It's Walt.
What's going on, man?
What's going on? I was listening to you know, the whole thing, and he's got a fan. Yeah, hello?
I appreciate that. That's a blessing, brother.
Oh, no problem, man. You got a fan.
You from,
I was doing everything. Pittsburgh.
Okay, that's what's up.
All day, yeah. Man. We got Pittsburgh in the building. Man, why don't you go ahead and follow me, too, on that Instagram, man.
Yeah, shout out to social media. Shout out to social media, Facebook, Instagram, everything.
Yeah, my Instagram, YUNGZEKELBC. You know, and it's just Young Zeke on Facebook, but I'm over the max on that joint. I probably got to create a whole other one. you know, LBC, everything, Young Zeke LBC, man. You can find me, Google me, Young Zeke. You know what I'm saying?
All right, man, cool.
Got it.
All right, get yourself a new fan, man.
I will follow you back, man. So, you know, I'm going to follow back. I follow you back, you know. You know, hey.
He ain't Hollywood either. Yeah.
Nah, man, watch the moves, man. I'm a real person, so I want to show people, you know, real people, you know, that's really real deal, you know, real dudes out here in the field that it can really possibly happen, bro, if you put your all into that shit. And we ain't going to put nothing in the wheelhouse. You know what I'm saying? That's where I'm at with it.
Yes.
Hey,
right,
Zeke.
Cool.
And Zeke, before you jump off, too, on your picture we ran for the promotion for you coming on the show, can we shout out that LBC Movement T-shirt company as well that you were rocking?
Oh, yes, sir. LBC Movement, yes, sir. Shout them out.
Yes, LBC Movement, y'all. You can find them on Instagram. You know, just punch up LBC Movement, you'll find it. And that's, look, they y'all doing big things out there, man. You know, I mean, we're just so honored. We're so privileged. We're so appreciative for you on your birthday. Once again, happy born, man. And we really, really appreciate you. And come back anytime, man, please.
Oh, you know, most definitely, y'all. Y'all so real, man. I'll be back like tomorrow. Zoom.